Canon C70 was announced because we just didn't have enough cameras in 2020. But this is another very exciting one, so I have to react again. And I'm just going to watch some other people's videos that have had hands-on experience because I'm a C200 user. This is right up my alley. And I bought the C200 kind of late. Like, I got it 2 years ago, and it's almost 5 years old now. And Canon says that the C70 is between the C100 and the C200. But I think what we're going to see here is that's not true at all. This is better than both. And you know what? If you're currently using a C500 Mark II or a C300 Mark III, this might even make you rethink those a little bit, depending how you use them. Real quick, the big things it's missing, there's no SDI output, which drives me crazy. Why did they do HDMI only? I would have rathered only SDI, I think. I don't know. It doesn't shoot RAW, even though it uses the sensor from the C300 Mark III. So it's just gonna use all of the 10-bit codecs instead. And there is no in-body sensor stabilization. So you're relying either on what the lens is doing or also the digital, which is available in the C300 as well. So anyway, let's start watching some videos. This first one comes from ProAV TV. They do such a good job of their reviews and breakdowns, so I highly recommend checking them out. Of course, the C70 video is no exception.
Is the Canon C70. Canon's first RF mount cinema camera and their smallest cinema camera yet.
This is a lot of the reason I'm interested in this camera and also in the Red Komodo, because having something that is a true cinema camera and is not making any compromises in terms of image quality in a small body is very appealing and important. There have been jobs where we ended up shooting on a Canon R instead of the C200, because we either, you know, couldn't load it on the stabilization, or we were traveling and we weren't able to pack the C200 or whatever. But this, I mean, this can fit in a backpack. This is a small kit and you don't need to add anything to it. It's really an all-in-one.
And when you're actually using this camera, any concerns over what it looks like just disappear. This might well be my favorite Canon camera to use yet in terms of physical design.
I just gotta say, that top handle, it's super ugly. I don't like the way Canon does their top handles. I would probably use a third party one. Maybe I'd try to get away without using one, because this really isn't meant to be built up. It's meant to stay pretty compact, I think.
The grip itself feels nice and large in your hands and is reassuringly sturdy. The audio controls are nestled neatly behind the flip out screen, and the top handle is mainly there just to give you something else to hold on.
Mainly there to throw in the garbage. Does this come with it, or do I have to pay for that?
So that you can easily control the autofocus. But with the C70, they've added this button here in the bottom left of the screen. This brings up a really well laid out selection of the most used controls for you to change with the touchscreen.
All these touch menus, this is awesome. They completely redid what happened on the C200. And I'm going to be using this a lot. There's so much more functionality. There's stuff that just didn't exist before, and it's much quicker to get to. It looks like they might have taken a few notes out of Blackmagic's playbook. Like, these big chunky rectangles are very easy to touch. You're not forced to use a little joystick to navigate the menus. You can just touch these big buttons. This is great. I like the way they did this.
For inputs, we've got two mini XLR sockets rather than full-size ones, which is an interesting move from Canon.
This is an interesting move. I don't know why they didn't do this on more cameras previously. This looks great. Like, it's still locking. It still has a ground. What's the downside of a smaller XLR? Is there any at all? I guess that you may already have big cables, but now you have to buy small ones. That's not a drawback. This is great. More cameras should do this. Blackmagic did this, right?
Middle ground option to give you the functionality of the larger XLR ports within a smaller footprint to match the slightly smaller camera design.
But this is one of those things that when I think about, do I want this or a Red Komodo, puts this ahead is that it's really nice to just plug in your audio and not have to think about it at all. C200 had great preamps. I never worried about adding external ones. And then plus, a video might go into it, but yeah, there's a built-in NDs that are very high quality. So now you don't have to install external NDs. Like, there's a lot of stuff packed into this small body that you don't necessarily get on either a Blackmagic or the Red that I like so much. By the way, that's the theme of all my videos lately. It's like Tyler's existential camera crisis. There's too many good ones. Which one do I buy? I've actually canceled two pre-orders this year because I just keep not making up my mind. And now, I don't know, is this going to be the next one I cancel? Because I already put my name down for it. But maybe this one will stick.
The lens mount is RF, making this Canon's first RF mount camera aimed purely at video. Now, it's not a user interchangeable mount like on the C300 Mark III and C500 Mark II. You are stuck with RF. But that's not the end of the world. RF is easy to adapt to pretty much anything out there, and Canon have RF to EF mount adapters, which work perfectly, and even keep full autofocus performance.
So I was really convinced of this after shooting with the Red Komodo for a little while. Having RF is perfect, because you can really put anything on there. You can adapt PL glass to this. You can put Leica lenses on here, which are beautiful. They are so small and make this kit very compact. RF is just incredibly flexible. So even if you don't want to upgrade your current lenses, you can still work with probably whatever you have. And then it gets better, wait.
You don't need the ND mount adapter anymore either, like you do on the R5 and EOS R, because the camera has proper built-in NDs. And Canon have a new adapter just for this camera. This is an RF to EF adapter with a built-in 0.71x focal reducer.
So what this does is gives you the full image circle of a full frame lens on this Super 35 sensor. So you can kind of screw it on here and just live with it as effectively an EF camera, which is way better than actually having an EF camera, because now you have all this flexibility. But it also comes with these additional like hex screws that you can Allen key into the camera, and they just stay there. Like, it's totally locked in and very secure. I feel like this is what I'll end up doing a lot of the time. I'll just have my EF glass on there very often. You also get little benefits, just like in the Metabones adapter, the speed boosters. Your lenses also become faster, so you get more light coming to the sensor with the exact same lenses. This is such a great setup. I love it. Also great is their choice of media. It uses SD cards. They are fast, more expensive ones if you want to be recording things like 120. I think V90 is the term. I hadn't even heard of that class of card. But yeah, UHS V90 is what I'm told you have to go buy. So maybe I have to buy some new SD cards. But that's a lot cheaper than buying CF Express Type B or CFast cards that some of the other cinema cameras or the Canon R5 take.
To SD cards, well, you've got two card slots hidden away here in the hand grip. And you can record pretty much whatever you want onto these. XFAVC to one and MP4 to another, same thing to both, 4K to one, 2K to another, simple proxies, or just use them for relay recording. You do get a lot of choice with your dual card slots.
Super smart, I love the way they did that. Let's go watch another video. So next up, this one's from CVP, and they did maybe the most extensive C70 review so far. It's 40 minutes long, they go really in depth. You got to check this. I mean, if you're spending the time to watch this, you're gonna watch all. You already watched these ones, didn't you? But I'll just skip through and talk about some of the most important things I think they covered here.
Canon are claiming that this sensor can capture 16 stops of dynamic range, and this is partly due to the implementation of the technique known as a dual gain output. This isn't a new technique and is used by arguably the most popular digital cinematography sensor ever made, the Arri Alexa.
So I have a little bit of an issue with this. There is no way that this camera really has 16 plus stops of dynamic range. This is, you know, never trust what the company says about it. But I do expect it to be amazing, because what we saw in the C300 Mark III was exceptional. There was so much dynamic range there. And as we're going to see in a second, they do some tests that show that it gets pretty close. So anyway, when you see people throw that number around, just be skeptical and let's wait until we see some independent controlled tests. I'm going to jump ahead to their exposure tests here, and the most interesting part. So this is when they underexpose the camera. I'm going to just let this play. What I see here is that this camera is very happy to be underexposed, which is completely the opposite of the C200. C200 had such noisy shadows, you had to massively overexpose. I often shoot like sometimes two stops overexposed just to get the maximum dynamic range at ISO 800. So CVP tested that, and compared to the C300, it looks similar. I don't know why they're different at all, really, but you know, they both hold up very well, even down to like -6 stops. Now, when they put it up next to the C200, we start to see a pretty big difference. So I already see the noise coming out the C200 at -3, -4, C200 already fell apart. And yeah, if they go down to -5, like the C200 is nothing. That is a garbage image. The C70 still looks good, like usable, very decent good. This is a whole different thing here. This is crazy. And if we take a look at their overexposure tests, we see that the colors in the C200 do hold up quite a bit better, especially saturation in the blues. They start to fall apart quite a bit on the C70 as it gets up there. They also hold together better in the C300. So this might be a restriction of the codec. Then here they also test the DGO samples. And you know, what we're seeing here is that those dual ISO or dual gain settings really do make a difference. I don't understand how it works at all, but what we're probably going to end up doing to really get the most out of this camera is underexpose it a little bit, or at least properly expose it, which is much nicer than what I had to do with the C200, where I'd always overexpose. They also did some quick ISO tests. I mean, you should watch their video to find out, but the punchline is you can turn it up very high and it still looks good, way more than the C200. C200, I never turn up past 3200 is too high for me. I stay at 1600 or below, but C70 is looking pretty sharp even at 3200.
Canon has also leaned into the vertical shooting trend, and this is why there is a quarter inch thread on the right hand side of the camera.
Thanks for talking about vertical video, but it's not a trend. It's going to stick around. Jesse Driftwood, back me up on this.
With this, you can mount the camera easily for shooting this way, and you can also change the layout and orientation of the menu in the deeper menu system for vertical operation.
So good, like that they thought about this menu thing. I don't understand why this isn't more common. This should be standard within like 2 or 3 years, honestly. Professional cameras need to do this because professional clients need vertical videos, and it's a huge pain to shoot them right now. So thanks.
Ability to change between shutter speed or angle and ISO or gain. You then also have a false color mode, which you can toggle on and off, and you even have a handy index built into the camera to understand where different parts of your image and exposure sit.
This is so good. This was a huge problem with the C200. You couldn't preview C-Log2 as you were shooting. That was like the whole point of shooting RAW. That's how you got the most dynamic range. So you basically have to guess your exposure, which is completely insane on a professional cinema camera. So now built in, there's false color that you couldn't even assign using external monitors on the C200. This is really, really helpful. I know it might seem like a small thing, but for somebody already using C200, this is great. This is going to save me a lot of trouble.
You have zebras, which you can output on the LCD or HDMI or both. You can have two different zebra percentages on at the same time, and this is handy. So as you can set two different values, one for your highlights and one for your skin tones. You then have a waveform or vectorscope that you can change a few parameters of.
These are all the things that should be on every cinema camera.
The only negative thing here is the inability to freely move this around the screen. They are fixed as to either left or right.
And it's still more than is available on the C200, by the way. You can customize this much more. Let's take a look at one more video. Here's one. I haven't seen this yet.
Underneath that, you have a function button, a magnification button, a push auto iris, a menu button, a set button, and the dial around it, a cancel button, and you also have a DC port for your power. Since this is a video camera, you can make it record for a lot longer period of time.
Funny thing, actually, this is one of the first cinema cameras I've seen that has auto ISO settings, which is very useful for a lot of applications, and it does it in a sort of more cinematic way. You can make it adapt more slowly, so it does more gradual transitions. I will actually use that.
Continuing on with the RF mount still, it has a combination IS, which means that you're able to use the lens IS as well as the in-body electronic image stabilization in the camera to all round create a really smooth shot.
Something to watch out for with the electronic stabilization, even though it works well, it also can create some weird jiggle that can kind of ruin your image. So don't use it all the time. I think it'd be worth assigning to a custom button so you can quickly turn it on and off. Look, if you want to know more about this, just subscribe. You already subscribed, didn't you? Didn't you? Okay, well, if you didn't, now is a great time because we're going to definitely talk about this camera a lot more on the podcast. And you're going to have to stay tuned to find out which camera will I eventually buy in 2025 when I can finally make up my mind. But to follow my day-by-day struggle, you should definitely be following me on Twitter @Stallman, because all my best little stray thoughts end up there. So I'll see you on Twitter.